Okay, the next item of business is debate on motion 2838 in the name of Miles Briggs on protecting local government funding in Scotland. I'd invite members who wish to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. Place an R in the chat function. I can advise the Chamber we're very tight for time, so I would be grateful if members would stick to their time allocation, and we'll probably have to accommodate any interventions in those allocations. And I call on Miles Briggs to speak to and move the motion for around 7 minutes, Mr. Briggs.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I want to open today's Scottish Conservative debate on local government finance by thanking all of those who work in our local authorities across Scotland. It is incredibly important that we thank them for what they have done during the pandemic and going the extra mile to support all of our communities. Now, today's debate is an important one for the Parliament to consider, because this SNP Green budget is not acceptable and will not help services recover from the pandemic. After 15 years of this SNP government underfunding local government in Scotland, there is increasing concern over the long-term financial sustainability of local government finances and the problems facing our Scottish councils that have been allowed to build up under this government with no reform or leadership shown by SNP ministers. Put simply, council leaders across Scotland have nothing else they can cut to save money or balance their books. Deputy Presiding Officer, how we adequately fund local government is vitally important and something I think we all agree on. For many individuals and families, the local services they depend on are delivered by their local council. SNP ministers have underfunded local councils for many years. From 2007 to 2019, the Scottish Government's budget increased at more than double the rate of the grant SNP ministers passed on to local councils. So the question today is a simple one. Why is it that SNP ministers have delivered such a poor financial settlement again this year? And yes.
Cabinet Secretary.
I respect the member's position in terms of supplementing local government budget. Where would he take it from?
Miles Briggs.
Well, we've been absolutely clear. And firstly, the Finance Secretary has seen £3.9 billion of additional Barnett consequentials from the UK government. That should be handed on to local government. And that's where we stand on this side of the chamber. We want to see a fair deal for local authorities, where the funding the Scottish Government receives is adequately handed on to local authorities as well. Very, very briefly.
Neil Gray.
I thank Miles Briggs for giving way. He'll note that the Scottish Fiscal Commission has said that year on year, the Scottish budget is down 5.2% accounting for inflation. Now, I want to see a fair settlement for local government being inflation-proof as well. But for him to be consistent, does he not reckon that the UK government needs to make sure that the Scottish budget is inflation-proof too?
Miles Briggs.
Well, in terms of that very fact, the member needs to understand that the money which his government he supports have been given hasn't handed on those Barnett consequentials to local authorities. And it's not just Barnett consequentials. Looking at the National Insurance Contribution Compensation, that hasn't also been passed on. So when he comes to raise these concerns in the Chamber, I think he needs to speak to his own ministers to make sure they've passed on these Barnett consequentials as well. And I hope that in bringing forward this debate today, it will give this SNP Green government a chance to think again and actually look at how they provide a fair deal for councils and the resources that they need to deliver such vital local services. Now, I fully respect they might not want to hear this from me, but maybe they should listen to their own council leaders. Now, I welcome the U-turn we've heard this week that Nicola Sturgeon, and I believe the Finance Secretary as well, will now meet with council leaders across Scotland after the furious backlash we've seen from SNP Green government's £371 million real-term cuts. But it's clear that as things stand, the budget settlement for local government will see a real-terms cut for local government funding. The core local government budget that has been frozen in cash terms, which represents a real-term cut of around £271 million, for our local authorities. An analysis by COSLA found that an additional policy obligations which are placed on local authorities now for 2022-23 have also been underfunded by £100 million. Now, SNP Green ministers have repeatedly said they respect and want to work in partnership with our local authorities. We'll now see, as we see the budget come back to Parliament next week, what that actually looks like and what is... In this amendment, which we've seen from the government today, no answers have been put forward. In fact, all we see is that ministers are offering a citizens' assembly to look at sources of local government funding. Deputy Presiding Officer, SNP ministers do not need a citizens' assembly to tell them that they are shortchanging local government. They simply need to pick up the phone to SNP council leaders. Deputy Presiding Officer, we need to see a sea change and we need to see a new partnership built between the Scottish Government and local authorities. That's why Scottish Conservatives are proposing a new fair funding formula to make sure that councils receive their fair share of funding when the Scottish Government do as well. Whilst the Barnett formula ensures that the Scottish Government's budget is linked to UK Government spending, there's no such protection for local government and the services which they provide. Now, this would help deliver a new financial framework and ensure councils automatically receive a set percentage of the Scottish Government budget each year, mirroring the relationship I've outlined between the Scottish Government and the UK Government. This would prevent SNP ministers from consistently asking our councils to do more with less. And the situation that we see today, where SNP and Green ministers, on the one hand, ring-fence council budgets for their Scottish Government priorities, and on the other hand, cut council funding. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, I hope today all parties will unite to support our local councils. SNP Green ministers cannot continue to simply pass the blame for their cuts to local councils. This SNP Green budget has yet again put council leaders at the length and breadth of Scotland in a position to have to make huge cuts to services or dramatically increase council tax at the very time ministers have received the record levels of funding from the UK Government. SNP Green ministers need to think again. The Scottish Government must provide these resources needed to fund our good schools, social care services and properly fund our councils to help build stronger and safer and more prosperous countries. That is something we should all unite around. I hope the Cabinet Secretary in this debate listening will understand she needs to look again at the Government budget she has provided, and I move the motion in my name.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Briggs. I now call on the Minister to speak to and move Amendment 2838.2. Mr Arthur, for around 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. And I'd like to open my contribution by welcoming this debate, and also, as Miles Briggs has done, and I'm sure many others will do as well, recognise the crucial role that councils play in delivering public services and supporting communities, and the part they play in delivering a national recovery. We may disagree at times, but hopefully we can all agree on this. We are ultimately today talking about difficult budget choices. Core to this afternoon's debate is the fact that the Scottish budget in 2022-23 is lower than it was in 2021-22. That is not my conclusion, nor that of the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Economy. That is the conclusion of the independent Scottish Fiscal Commission, who in their economic and fiscal forecast report said, and I quote, overall the Scottish budget in 2022-23 is 2.6% lower than in 21-22. After accounting for inflation, the reduction is 5.2%, a point made in an intervention by my colleague Neil Gray. Certainly.
Douglas Lumsden.
I thank the Minister for giving way. Could he maybe give us a bit of a comparison from what the budget was 2 years ago? Because, of course, last year we had a huge increase because of the COVID spend.
Minister.
What I would note is it was about 2 years ago that my colleague Kenny Gibson raised the issue of a new virus that had been detected in China in the Parliament, which I believe was the first mention of it. The difference between now and 2 years ago is we are still in the teeth of a global pandemic, and I appreciate Mr Lumsden's colleagues at Westminster might be waving their masks in the chamber and think the pandemic's over, but the reality is the pandemic certainly is not over, and there is a huge amount of work to be undertaken in recovery, and that has to be taken into account in the settlement that this government has given from Westminster. Now, Presiding Officer, despite a 5.2% reduction, the Scottish budget delivers record funding of £18 billion for health and social care, doubles the Scottish child payment and introduces free bus travel for everyone under the age of 22. It delivers an overall settlement to local government worth over £12.5 billion, an increase of £588.2 million in real terms. I will in a moment, Mr Briggs. In the context of a 5.2% real terms reduction in the overall budget, the local government settlement has increased by 5.1%, again in real terms. This growth in the overall settlement was acknowledged by the COSLA resource spokesperson in evidence to the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee last week. Having taken the decision to pass on all frontline health and care consequentials in full, we have also then protected local government by providing a flat cash core budget alongside a further £1.4 billion, which is transferred from other portfolios for joint priorities. Now, by definition, a flat cash core allocation does not take account of inflation. The Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy has acknowledged that we cannot inflation-proof any part of the Scottish Government budget, such as the nature of inflation right now. We do not underestimate the challenges this allocation presents, but it is simply not possible to inflation-proof all budget lines when the overall budget is not inflation-proofed. I'm afraid I need to make a wee bit more progress because I'm going to take an intervention from Mr Briggs in a moment. But in acknowledging these challenges, we must also be honest that pay increases and changes in the design of national insurance are themselves inflationary pressures. It is therefore not correct to claim that there is a real terms cut to the local government budget, and then also claim that it does not take account of pay inflation or increased employer national insurance contributions. I'm going to take an intervention from Mr Briggs to ask first.
Miles Briggs.
The Minister for taking this intervention. Can I ask two things? Firstly, COSLA have highlighted the fact that the Scottish Government have not handed on the National Insurance Contribution compensation of around £70 million. Now, why is that? And if this budget is so wonderful as he is making out, why does his fellow SNP leader of Renfrewshire Council, Ian Nicholson, why has he had to write to the First Minister to ask for this to be looked at again?
Minister.
Well, I recognise the challenges we face in our budget are ultimately a reflection of the challenges that we face as a consequence of the UK Government's settlement to the Scottish Parliament. And as I say, but look, we get to the core point because funding that is handed on to local government is funding that is not handed on elsewhere. So I recognise that some in the Chamber may disagree with the Government's decisions to pass on the frontline health and social care consequentials in full to help tackle child poverty and inequality by doubling the game-changing Scottish child payment, by providing over £500 million to councils to support investment in health and social care, to allocate £145 million extra for additional teachers and support staff, all the money to support the expansion of free school meals with an extra £64 million in revenue and £30 million of capital funding. Presiding Officer, we take the view that these are not simply Scottish Government priorities. They are joint priorities with local government, and I believe they also attract cross-party support from across this chamber. However, if opposition parties do not agree with these investments, they are fully entitled to propose alternative but balanced funding proposals ahead of the budget bill next week. The budget also provides councils with a number of flexibilities, including over council tax rate setting, as they requested, and we have reaffirmed our commitment to developing a local government fiscal framework in partnership with COSLA. And I want to be clear that any framework must be developed in partnership with local government. It must be workable and learn lessons from the implementation of the broader Scottish fiscal framework. And crucially, it cannot put funding up for the NHS at risk. It will be important for local government to bring forward fiscal framework proposals that can then be explored in partnership. But there's no reason why these proposals need only come from local government. In this regard, I want to just note in concluding the Conservatives' motion. I want to welcome the contribution that Miles Briggs is making, and I hope that other Conservative members, or Mr Briggs or Ms Smith, in summing up later on in this debate, can provide more detail about how that would work in practice, because clearly there would be significant consequences elsewhere in the budget. Just to conclude, Presiding Officer, let me again welcome this debate and say that I'm looking forward to the contributions from members across the Chamber.
Thank you very much, Minister. I now call on Mark Griffin to speak to Move Amendment 2838.1 for around 5 minutes, Mr Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Here we are again, another debate about local government budgets, another SNP budget, another devastating raid on those council budgets providing absolutely vital local services. Another £371 million gone from the core revenue budget in real terms, and a further 4% ring-fenced. The Minister, like many of his ministerial colleagues, have stood up and said how much they value local government, how much they value local government workers, I think it was President Biden who said, "Don't tell me what you value. Show me your budget and I'll tell you." And local government workers, people who rely on local government services, hear that loud and clear from this government. Certainly.
Cabinet Secretary.
I assume, therefore, the member wants to see the local government settlement go up. Every penny is allocated, so where would it come from in the budget?
Mark Griffin.
It's clear that the Scottish Government's budget has increased. We are asking for the Scottish Government to respect local government. The Scottish Government's budget, according to the Accounts Commission, they have said that since 2013-14, budgets have reduced. Granted that budgets have reduced in the Scottish Government by 0.8%. At the same time, the Scottish Government have hammered local government, cutting their budgets by 4.7%, magnifying every single budget cut that they've been passed on by the Tories and hammering local services. Presiding Officer, we'll support the motion today because we believe it's simply unsustainable for the SNP to continue cutting council budgets to the bone. Services are already at breaking point. And today, I would normally take as many as you like, but I only have 5 minutes. Today, the President of COSLA said that tax rises are inevitable, that cuts are inevitable, unless, as the motion states, the government delivers an improved financial settlement. Now, these aren't choices. These are SNP cuts forced on local government as part of a sustained campaign that's been going on for a decade now and has cost services £937 million since 2013. I think where the European Charter of Local Government Local Self-Government Bill in force, the government would clearly be in breach of that legislation. But there are a couple of differences this year than we've seen in the previous decade. The Minister and Cabinet Secretary's SNP Council colleagues have finally said in public what they've been saying behind closed doors for a decade, that they can't cope with any more cuts. We also know that the Greens are in government and have signed off on these cuts, so the Cabinet Secretary has no chance to find that extra couple of £100 million for a deal. But most concerning of all, that we're in the grip of the biggest cost of living crisis that we have seen in years. Inflation is the highest that has been in 5 years. And the Cabinet Secretary took to the radio this morning to say that she couldn't inflation-proof budgets, that it was inflation's doing that ring-fence spending increased, jumping from 58% to 62%. This year, that's what she said, but she couldn't say who caused the portion of the budget which councils have maximum flexibility for delivering local priorities to fall. And it's worth knowing that in 2013, that controlled spend was just 25%. It's almost as if the SNP government wants us to forget that local councils are democratically elected, accountable to their own voters. The Cabinet Secretary also said that only 7% of the budget is ring-fenced for grants for SNP government projects. But even on that count, which I dispute, according to Spice, that's grown from 0.1% of budgets in 2013, grown 70 times over. Now, we agree that local governments need a fiscal framework to make decisions which are best for their local communities, but we're alive to the fears that this could bake in a decade of cuts. Our amendment seeks to qualify the set percentage the Conservative motion proposes, as we can't accept continued pernicious ring fencing to take place within that set proportion of the Scottish budget. And finally, Presiding Officer, the issue of local government staff pay must be heard. This budget is disastrous for the tireless army of local government workers. Not only do they have the task of implementing yet more cuts, they are doing so in spite of the exhausting task of keeping the country moving through 2 years of the pandemic. Youth and community workers, carers, cleansing staff, teaching assistants, street cleaners and so many more have worked flat out to keep the services that we all have relied on, that we've all clapped for, still going. But 55% of them earn below £25,000 per annum. And at committee last week, Joanna Baxter of Unison told us how angry and frustrated they were and that councils will see a difficult industrial landscape ahead. So, Presiding Officer, I would ask the government to reconsider, deliver a budget that can deliver a fair pay increase for staff, deliver a fair settlement for local authorities and remove the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Griffin. I now call on Willie Rennie for around 4 minutes, Mr Rennie.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. We have learned something new today, was that Kenny Gibson discovered COVID. But what we already knew was that the local government has had the rough end of the SNP government's priorities for years. This year's budget is no different from all the rest, as Mr Gibson knows. We get the usual conjurer's trick from ministers, who send ring-fenced parcels of money to local councils for new tasks and claim that money is for old tasks. The money goes up, but the cost of the new responsibilities go even higher, which leaves councils to cut other services. This year's funding settlement is harsher than most, with hundreds of millions of pounds of cuts. That's why councillors of all political persuasions, including SNP councillors, are so angry this year. Whilst other services across the UK have been compensated for the national insurance increase, local government here has been left with a big hole in its finances. So when, not just now, I've only got 4 minutes, I would love to take an intervention. So when the roads are full of potholes, the streets are covered in rubbish, the schools don't have the funds that they need, and community services are shut, there is just one place that they should look, and that is the SNP government sitting in St Andrew's House. Meanwhile, the SNP's 15-year-old plans to scrap the unfair council tax have not moved one inch forward. I have attended endless government talking shops on this. And if hot air could scrap the council tax, we'd have a new tax every single year. But that's all going to change now. I have new great hope because the Greens are in government. I am looking forward to the scrapping of the council tax bill forthcoming, led by Patrick Harvey. We all live in great hope of new times. But today is a rehash of last year's Conservative motion. They have not learnt from their mistakes. We all remember that in the past, the UK government has allocated Barnett consequentials for health. The Scottish Conservatives have wanted it to be guaranteed for health. Well, not anymore. In 2018, the then Prime Minister, Theresa May, said that they would increase National Health Service funding, which would mean £2 billion of consequentials for the Scottish Government by 2023. Back then, the Secretary of State for Scotland, Dave Mundell, remember those glory days, I urge the First Minister and the Scottish Government to invest this extra money in improving health services. With today's motion, all of that would be completely out of the window. Under the Conservatives' plan today, between 2018 and 2023, more than £600 million would be automatically removed from the NHS Scotland annual budget. People expect their Parliament to judge the different needs and not just delete hundreds of millions of pounds from a budget because the Conservative computer tells them to do exactly that. Instead, we need a fair funding settlement for councils based on good judgment of MSPs. And just as Holyrood does, I want councils to be able to raise the majority of the money that they spent. If they control the purse strings, they are free to determine their own future in partnership with the communities that they serve. If the councils or the voters do not like the decisions on tax and spend, they can chuck them out. We need a framework that nurtures that relationship. And that is why we cannot support the Conservative motion today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Rennie. We now move to the open debate. And after that build-up from Mr Rennie, I call Kenneth Gibson for around 4 minutes to be followed
Thank
by...
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Like all budgets, 22-23 is about choice, prioritising how best to invest in services, infrastructure and people at a time of financial challenge. With fiscal rectitude, the Cabinet Secretary and wider Scottish Government has made its choices and set out its priorities. As we know, the Scottish budget is limited by the forecast of the independent Scottish Fiscal Commission, beyond which the Finance Secretary cannot go. I too would like to see more resources allocated to local government. Who wouldn't? But this year, the Scottish Fiscal Commission has made clear that this Parliament will suffer a real terms cut courtesy of Miles Tory bosses at Westminster. The SFC said in evidence to the Finance and Public Administration Committee that, and it's worth quoting again, the overall Scottish budget in 22-23 is 2.6% lower than in 21-22. After accounting for inflation, the reduction is 5.2%. So I say to Miles Briggs and his colleagues, tell us how much an additional resource should be allocated to local government. He didn't say. From actual Scottish Government resources, not the mythical funds he mentioned, and from where should these extra resources demanded be found, given that Scottish ministers have such limited room for manoeuvre? Should we raise taxes? If so, which ones? Who should pay? And how much should they pay? If money is to be reallocated from other Scottish budget portfolios, which ones? Health, transport, net zero? And how much should each portfolio budget be cut to provide additional funding for local authorities? Unless answers are forthcoming, it just sounds like hot air and posturing to me. Oh, well, it's your motion, Mr Briggs. I'll take it.
Miles Briggs.
I'm grateful for... He will be aware that the Scottish Government budget has increased by 7%. Now, that is more than inflation, so that's exactly where the funding can come from. And maybe another suggestion, why don't we not spend £7 million on ministers being ferried around and give that to local authorities?
Kenneth Gibson.
I wonder how much Whitehall actually spends in ferrying ministers around. I mean, well, these mythical figures are a nonsense, which is why the Independent Fiscal Commission dismissed them. We're talking about reality here. Presiding officer, I'm also curious as to how genuine the concern of Tory MSPs is for our local authorities. Can Miles please tell us if local government is so important to the party he supports so devotedly? Why has the Tory government eviscerated it so ferociously south of the border? According to the Institute for Government Resources to English and Welsh local authorities, including retained business rates for the UK Tory government, were cut by an eye-watering 37% in real terms between 2010 and 2019-20, from 41 to 26 billion in 2019-20 prices. Well, funding from the UK coalition, because we clearly recall the Lib Dem role in that, and Tory governments were slashed, rates of council tax were increased, and English local authorities raised 25% more council tax in real terms in 2019-20 compared to a decade earlier. Comparing Scotland to England and Wales, there is simply no relationship between the solid support the Scottish Government has provided to our councils post-financial crash and through austerity and the devastation wrought on local authority services down south. The reality is that no one takes seriously Tory claims to be advocates for local government. Labour, of course, just want to drone on about alleged SNP cuts, which they seek to blame on the Scottish Government rather than their Better Together allies. Yet when former leader Jeremy Corbyn, remember him, was asked about the depths of cuts imposed by Labour in Wales, Mr Corbyn meekly said they had no choice but to pass them on from Westminster. In a garden ring fencing, 7% they bleat. Well, I recall that there were 60 budget lines ring fenced for local government when the Lib Dems and Labour were last in power, and Wendy Alexander calling for full ring fencing of local government budgets. But Willie Rennie was right to say that in this Tory motion is a bizarre idea that councils should automatically receive a set percentage of the Scottish Government budget each year. Why local government and not health, education, justice? With impending 5.2% cut, this daft Tory proposal will be guaranteed to deliver less funding to our councils. And all governments need flexibility. They don't have a crystal ball to see into the future to where unexpected financial shocks might arise. For instance, who saw the financial impact of a pandemic coming down the road in 2019? Presiding officer, through methods ranging from resource borrowing to the less palatable fiscal drag, the Scottish Government is delivering local government tax flexibility in the best possible settlement possible under the financial straitjacket imposed upon us by the Tories at Westminster. Only with independence will the Scottish Government have the ability to deliver the budget for local government and every other portfolio they will all want to see. Support
now,
the Scottish
Gibson.
Government amendment.
Boy, to be followed by Michelle Thompson. 4 minutes, please, Mr.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. He might be a world leading epidemiologist, but he can't make his sums add up. I would like to thank my Scottish Conservative colleagues for bringing forward this important debate today. But before I begin, can I draw attention to my register of interests as a serving councillor in East Lothian? The financial crisis facing Scotland's local authorities is stark, and it is entirely one of the SNP's making. As a councillor representing a ward in East Lothian, which is within the south of Scotland region, I'm only too well aware of how grave the problem is facing our council. Let there be no doubt, the SNP's austerity agenda for local government continues, with East Lothian Council, no, I won't give way, with East Lothian Council set to lose out on £4.5 million this year. The government have starved this and every other council for years, and the situation is now serious. The picture this paints is so bad, it now looks vindictive. Despite a record settlement from Westminster, The Scottish Government has cut East Lothian's budget by £1 million in real terms next year, and it will be a further £3.5 million worse off as a result to changes to the floor-based funding formula, which pools funding with other council. It is simply unfair that one of the fastest-growing areas in Scotland is being repeatedly penalised by the SNP, and I urge the Scottish Government to stop shortchanging the residents of East Lothian. But it's not just the people of East Lothian that are losing out. Right across Scotland, the picture is the same. As Miles Briggs pointed out, COSLA estimates that £371 million of core funding for Scottish councils will be cut in real terms this year alone. That's £371 million of cuts to roads, social services, education, housing and refuse collection across Scotland. And whilst the SNP government starves communities of funding, it is forcing councils to raise taxes for millions of Scots just at the time... No, I won't give way. I've only got 4 minutes, sadly. Just at the time when the cost of living is rising. And that's why the Scottish Conservatives are proposing a clear solution to this crisis, a crisis of the SNP's making. We want to see a permanent settlement for Scotland's councils which ring-fences a percentage of the overall Scottish budget for councils' funding. We need a fair deal for our councils, and we need that deal now. But, Deputy Presiding Officer, the situation emerging in front of us is starker and more serious still. After years of failing to fund our councils, the SNP are stepping up their assault. The Scottish Government's plan for the creation of a national care service is an assault on local government and an attack on local accountability. What started with the Feely review into adult social care, arguably an area in need of funding, reform and new thinking, is fast becoming just the latest in a long line of SNP power grabs, and it is perhaps the greatest power grab in the history of devolution. And let's look at the words of COSLA President Alison Everson. She described the National Care Service plan as an attack on localism. And on these latest cuts to local councils, all 32 Scottish council leaders have written to the First Minister to tell her that enough is enough. We know that the SNP don't do dissent, but even council leaders from the First Minister's own party are worried. John Alexander, SNP council leader for Dundee, has described the recent Scottish budget as perhaps, and I quote, the toughest in recent memory. After years of hollowing out councils, the SNP is now mounting a direct assault on local government. The SNP wants to scrap local accountability. It wants to impose total ministerial control on care. The SNP is continuing to raid council budgets to pay for pet projects. When it comes to the SNP and our cash-strapped councils, COSLA is correct. Enough is enough.
Thank you, Mr Hoy. I now call Michelle Thompson, who will be followed by Paula Kane. A strict 4 minutes as well, Mr Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Recent days have once again highlighted the hypocrisy of the Tories. Perhaps they've already forgotten the waste of public funds in awarding PPE contracts to their pals, the writing off only yesterday of an incredible £4.3 billion for fraudulent business COVID claims, and were instead focusing on their penchant for partying. Even as the Tories were laying down the motion for today's debate, only this week in Westminster, their Home Secretary, Priti Patel, launched an outrageous and ill-informed attack on Scotland's councils. So forgive me if I'm a little cynical about Tory support of Scotland's councils. The motion is defective, and I'll focus just on a few of the issues given the limited time available. The single ask in the motion is to create a funding settlement that is entirely fixed a percentage of the Scottish Government budget, and it's flawed. For example, it doesn't allow the flexibility for the government to deal with unforeseen shocks, and this has been mentioned earlier in the debate. The current pandemic is a good example, but the fallout from the 2008 economic crisis was another example. Now, had the Tories put down a sensible economic motion seeking to support calls by many for increased borrowing powers, that would have been a motion we could all have rallied around. The motion's also at serious fault in failing to consider economic uncertainties at the current time. For example, during the 2021 forecast by the OBR, the Scottish Fiscal Commission and independent forecasters were all subject to considerable change. The forecasts published in the lead-up to the Scottish Budget, of course, failed to take account of the then unknown and arguably unanticipated Omicron variant. This is likely to lead to further significant downward changes in forecasts. And so to fail to understand the consequence of such uncertainties for government funding is simply not realistic. Of course, one other shock, the word that dare not speak its name, but this time deliberately created by the Tories, has been Brexit. This has had serious implications for local authorities. For example, the UK government's plans for the replacement of EU structural funds. In the response to information requests from the Finance and Public Administration Committee, very serious concerns have been raised by Scotland's local authorities. These include the questioning of a seriously flawed methodology that doesn't respond to Scottish conditions and a failure by the UK government to fund the resources required to operate the replacement funds. Yet nowhere in this motion is the UK government called out for the harms being inflicted by them on Scottish councils. Of course, the Scottish Government finally and our local authorities will be constrained by the operation of the Tory-inspired Internal Market Act and Subsidy Control Bill going through Westminster. Despite all of these uncertainties and constraints, the Tory motion fails to recognise, despite all of the challenges, the Scottish Government has come up with an overall settlement in excess of £12.5 billion, representing a real terms increase of some 5.1%. And as has been pointed out previously, the Scottish Government is already committed to working with COSLA to develop a rules-based fiscal framework to support future funding settlements for local government. And I hope all parties can support this. So finally, no lectures, please, from a Tory party that rewards its own, attacks our local authorities from Westminster and blocks at every turn the need to enhance this Parliament's financial and economic powers. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Thompson. I now call on Paul O'Kane, who also joins us remotely, to be followed by Ross Greer. Again, 4 minutes, please, Mr O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I begin by reminding members that I am still a member of East Renfrewshire Council, and I've been a councillor there for 10 years almost, and it has and continues to be one of the most fulfilling roles I've ever had the honour to do, and indeed representing the community you grew up in, I think is a very honourable thing. As a councillor, I have been the convener for education and the deputy of the council, and I've seen firsthand over the last decade how this SNP government has worn down local government, forcing those in charge to cut services as the budgets are continually cut year after year. It has been incredibly challenging to be a local representative when you are consistently faced with budget processes which bring more and more cuts. Indeed, I think of the anxious wait that councillors have every year awaiting a settlement from this government, the long meetings to discuss how to plug some of the gaps using reserves or council tax, and the painful consultation processes trying to decide what the least worst option is in a sea of unthinkable options. And I'm not sure if colleagues in the chamber who haven't had to do any of this can fully understand the sleepless nights it causes, thinking about people's jobs, people's services, and the communities we care about. And it's not just councillors who feel like this. It's also the staff who work so hard in local government too. Because nobody seeks out a career in a local authority looking to make cuts. But essentially, the choices of government have made so many of our dedicated officers in local government managers of cuts. And I have watched the stress of hardworking officers in education, social work and environment having to spend so much time coming up with unthinkable options just to square the budget. We've also seen our workers stretched thin as they're asked to do more and more to make up the gaps created by cuts. Our key workers, people the First Minister and the Cabinet applauded every Thursday night in the pandemic. Stress is being piled onto these workers, 55% of which are paid below £25,000 a year. That is shameful. In my ward, I see every day how cuts forced down from government are hitting our communities and the most vulnerable. Pupil support assistant numbers cut, road budgets reduced, social care on its knees. The reality of all of this, Deputy Presiding Officer, is that people across Scotland are being failed, and there is no sign of it getting better. But we hear from the government that they have delivered initiatives like free early learning and childcare and free school meals, but there is not nearly enough funding to deliver the reality of this on the ground and to ensure that the core infrastructure can be maintained make these things happen. And of course, the government are always keen to hold up their manifesto commitments. But what is the reality on the ground where local government has to deliver these? The reform to council tax, it never appeared. Funding to refurbish every play park in Scotland, barely a fraction of what was required. A free bike for every pupil who can't afford one, consigned to a pilot that doesn't even scratch the surface. Empty words and broken promises from the SNP. And what does the future hold? Even more cuts to local government budgets. Last month's budget saw a core funding cut of £371 million. A budget that makes no provision for pay, inflation or increased demand for services, nor indeed, as we have already heard, for the increased burden of national insurance contributions. To place these cuts in a wider context, this is all happening as we see one of the biggest increases to the cost of living in decades. Such is the scale of the problem, is that we have now seen unprecedented reaction from all 32 council leaders in Scotland, calling for the government to meet with them to discuss the settlement. Because enough is enough. So in concluding, presiding officer, what is clear is that the SNP government have failed local government and those who live in our communities. Because cuts to councils are cuts to communities. And if the course does not change, the very fabric of our communities will be irreparably damaged. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr O'Kane. I now call on Ross Greer to be followed by Douglas Lumsden. Again, 4 minutes, Mr Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's been a pattern for years in this Parliament that the Tory benches uttered not a word of concern or objection when their Westminster colleagues cut Scotland's budget, but they rushed to this chamber to condemn every perceived cut then made by the Scottish Government's budget and to make spending demands which exceed the money actually available. As has already been mentioned, this year they're going as far as claiming that a 5% real terms cut from Westminster is actually somehow an increase. We're all guilty of picking and choosing the figures which suit our position best in these debates, but this goes beyond that. It's actively misleading to claim that a cut is a significant increase. And as the Government amendment notes, it's contrary to the Scottish Fiscal Commission's own analysis. Not one Conservative member in this debate so far has been able to explain how the Scottish Government is expected to sustain the costs of the pandemic from core funds without that impacting on other services. But that's the result of COVID consequentials being withdrawn when COVID and its effects are still very much with us. As an example, bus and rail use are down by a third in Scotland, and that's not expected to change significantly in the next financial year. That requires significant subsidy to keep essential services operating. But without last year's COVID consequentials repeating, the choice is to either provide those subsidies from the core transport budget, putting pressure on other areas, or to let our public transport system collapse overnight as operators withdraw. Now, I presume the Tories don't want to see that collapse. I'd be delighted to accept an intervention from Mr Briggs, but I simply want to repeat the question that's been asked him of others. With £371 million being causeless asked, one repeated by the Conservatives today, and all money available to the Scottish Government already allocated, from which budget would he cut £371 million to fulfil what causeless are asking for?
Miles Briggs.
Absolutely clear, as I've said before, and the Government's got £3.9 billion in additional consequences. These are actually this Government's decisions to cut funding. And we haven't had an answer quite yet from ministers over the national insurance increase. Ministers he supports, sitting on the front bench here, have £70 million they have not passed on to local authorities for the national insurance compensation. Why is that? And will him and his Green colleagues ask them to do that at the coming budget?
Ross Greer, and I will give you back that time.
Thank you. That's much appreciated, Presiding Officer. In the first instance, there is no specific consequential for the national insurance increase.
Yes, there is.
There are broad consequentials, but Mr Briggs has yet again failed to answer the question. Every penny available to the Scottish Government has been allocated. There's no money sitting unallocated, but the Conservatives won't explain where they will cut £371 million. Cosler's point is entirely legitimate. It's disingenuous of the Conservatives to pretend that it can be fulfilled without significant impacts elsewhere. But despite the pressures on the Scottish Government, this budget delivers a real terms increase of more than £500 million to councils. That includes an additional £145 million for teacher recruitment. That's enough to fund 2,500 additional posts. There's £30 million in capital funding to facilitate the expansion of free school meals and £60 million for those meals themselves. There's £175 million, no, not at this point, thank you. There's £175 million to fund the pay increase for care sector workers and £200 million more for health and social care. That's not me suggesting that everything is rosy. COSLA do have a perfectly legitimate case to make for more funding. They're not the only ones. This budget represents the fairest possible distribution of extremely limited funding in extremely challenging circumstances. And I've yet to hear from exactly where the opposition would cut £371 million to fulfil what COSLA are asking for, or what changes they would make to tax policy to raise that. In fact, the only income tax policy I can recall the Tories bringing to this Parliament since that power was devolved was a proposed cut for the top 15% of earners, which would have cut a further £500 million from our budget. Back in 2018, the Greens made changes to income tax to make it more progressive and to raise additional funds for public services. This year, a further change was made, freezing the higher and top rate thresholds, which will raise a further £106 million. Now, I happen to be of the view that we will need to raise significant additional amounts of money from a variety of sources, both existing and new, over this term, if we're to meet the objectives we all share around child poverty reduction and reaching net zero in particular. And achieving those targets will require a significant increase in funding for local government. That's why the shared policy programme agreed by the two parties of government will commit, does commit, to delivering both the fiscal framework for local government and a citizens' assembly on local government funding. Now, I have my concerns, basically those outlined by Willie Rennie, about the Conservatives' proposal, but I welcome the fact that they have at least brought a specific proposal for once to this chamber. Both the fiscal framework and the citizens' assembly will be transformational in the long term, but I accept they don't ease the pressure on councils in this financial year. The Scottish Government has done what it can.
You do need to conclude now, Mr. Greer.
The Scottish Government has done what it can to ease that pressure. If the Tories are serious about removing it completely, they should look to their own colleagues in government at Westminster, because this is the situation of the Conservative Party's making.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Greer. I now call on Douglas Lumsden, who will be followed by John Mason again. 4 minutes, Mr. Lumsden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'd like to remind members of my register of interest that shows I'm still a councillor at Aberdeen City Council. Throughout this pandemic, our local authorities have been on the front line of providing essential services to our communities. They have gone above and beyond, organised food parcels, online learning, emergency assistance, support to resilience groups. The list goes on. And they have done this while continuing to provide all the usual essential services, such as caring for our most vulnerable, fixing our roads, emptying our bins and providing community support. They deserve our thanks, our praise, and more importantly, financial support to enable them to continue to provide these essential services. This is why the funding settlement announced by the Cabinet Secretary is nothing short of a slap in the face to all those local authorities that have gone above and beyond what is expected on behalf of this devolved government. Up and down Scotland, councillors are currently poring over budget spreadsheets, agonising over how they can continue to provide these essential services while facing a huge budget cut. They're all desperate not to raise council tax too much, given the pressure on the cost of living in their communities. But this Scottish Government has passed the buck. They have cut core council funding and now expect councillors to raise council tax to fill the gap or reduce vital services. It's simply not acceptable. And council leaders are in agreement that the Scottish Government are ignoring them, with calls for meetings being ignored, engagement lacking, and major policy announcements like the National Care Service consultation been made with no discussion or no collaboration. The way this devolved Scottish Government treats their local government partners is a disgrace. Deputy Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government has many warm words regarding prevention in terms of drug deaths, but also matters like climate change and educational attainment. Early intervention is key to so many challenges that we're facing. But it's local government where the prevention work takes place. It's local government that provides the youth clubs, the social centres, sports facilities, lunch clubs, school counselling services. And all of these much-needed facilities are now at risk as local government budgets continue. Without these preventative services, how will we continue to tackle the challenges that we face at the earliest possible opportunity? If this devolved government was serious about prevention, then they would be investing in local government and not pulling the rug from under their feet. And I turn, finally, Deputy Presiding Officer, to the question of national insurance and ask the Minister to answer this one question. COSLA confirmed to local leaders this week that the Scottish Government has received consequential payments to cover the national insurance rise for local government employees. And yet they're refusing to pass this on to councils. In England, councils are being funded for the national insurance increase, but not in Scotland. When local government is the backbone of our communities, surely will the Minister give us assurance today that the consequential money received for national insurance contributions will now be passed over to local authorities. Presiding officer, our local councils have done us proud over the last 2 years. We should be thanking them, building them up, recognising the vital work that they do and treating them like equal partners in government. Instead, this government treats them with contempt. It's time to give our local councils a fair funding settlement that reflects the vital work that they do, helping them to deliver that work and in turn strengthening our towns, villages and our local communities. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Lumsden. Before calling Mr Mason, I would just remind colleagues that Mr Mason is the final speaker in the open debate and everybody that's participated in the debate needs to be here for closing speeches. Mr Mason, up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to take part in today's debate. As others have said, firstly, I find the Conservative motion interesting in that it seeks more money for local government but does not say where that money should come from, and the Labour amendment takes a similar path. Of course, the main options for raising such money are, firstly, increased taxes, which I personally would be open to. However, normally we understand the Tories are against tax rises, and in fact, they usually do a lot of gurning and whining that our income tax is higher than England's. Or secondly, the other main option is to reduce expenditure somewhere else. And the most obvious option to cut is NHS spending, as that is one of the largest parts of the Scottish budget. So which is it? Are the Conservatives now open to tax increases? Or are they seriously suggesting that we cut the health budget while we're still not out of the COVID pandemic? For a party which claims to understand business and the economy, surely they understand that the books have to balance. But I see nothing in their motion about the source of any additional funding for local government, and neither have they given the reply to previous speakers. Secondly, I find the concept of a ring-fenced percentage of the budget somewhat bizarre. That would take away the powers of this Parliament and MSPs to examine the budget each year and consider where the needs are greatest. Thus, over the last couple of years, with the COVID pandemic, we have had to reprioritise funding, and that has particularly emphasised the health services, but also business support and, in fact, local government too. So I have to say that I do not think ring-fencing the budget and, by implication, ignoring any kinds of needs assessment would be, to say the least, reasonable. There is also the separate but linked question of allocating local government funding between the 32 councils. I would also argue that that should be based on need as well. If Aberdeen was one of the richest parts of Scotland and so got less central funding than that was right at the time. But if that is no longer the case, then by all means, let us reassess the needs. But that process has to be in conjunction with COSLA and all the councils. The wider question is how local government should be funded and whether more of that funding should be raised directly by local councils. I would very much support that concept. Apart from anything else, that would give councils more freedom by reducing their dependence on the centre for funding. But there will always be the need for some central funding in order to support councils who cannot raise the resources which they require for the needs in their area. But again, this has to be based on need rather than giving everyone the same. And I would dearly love, as others have said, and I would be in agreement with, that we should replace council tax, which is a question that has been dragging on far too long. Particularly Willie Rennie mentioned that. So at some point, we do need to bite the bullet here in Parliament and agree on a replacement tax. Such a tax will not please everyone, and there will inevitably be winners and losers. But better funding for local government going forward will inevitably mean that those who are earning more or who have more property and other assets will need to pay more. Let's remember that tax paid as a share of GDP is only around 33% in the UK, compared to 45% in France and 46% in Denmark. For too long, we have tried to run quality public services in this country without paying the sensible levels of tax that are required. So I do very much welcome the work which the Scottish Government and the Finance Committee are planning to do on where we are going with tax in Scotland in the longer term. So in summary, we need to be sensible. We can only spend the money we have. And if the Conservatives or Labour want more for local government, they still have to tell us where it is coming from. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Minister. We now move to closing speeches, and I call firstly Daniel Johnson for 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This is undoubtedly a very important topic, but I'm afraid I'm not sure this afternoon's debate has shed hugely much more light. But let me try and build some consensus, as indeed invited by Tom Arthur at the beginning, which is that I think local government is hugely important. And I think actually part of the problem is we keep discussing council funding and local government funding when the reality is that this money pays for roads, it pays for schools, it pays for libraries, it pays for playgrounds, it pays for social services that keep the most vulnerable safe. And I think that's what we need to focus on. And like Douglas Lumsden said, it's also local government and local councils who have been at the forefront of delivery the most vital services through the COVID response. But therein, I think we struggle to find much more consensus, because the reality is this is not just about this budget, but about the legacy of 10 years of cuts and underfunding of local government. That's why on roads, we've seen potholes increase by fivefold over the last decade. And the £260,000 worth of compensation payments to motorists in Edinburgh just because of those potholes. On libraries, those have been cut by a third and 32% less librarians. We've seen non-core support staff in our schools slashed across the country. So it's difficult to engage with SNP members who claim there are no cuts, there are only increases, when the Accounts Commission themselves point out very clearly that there has been a 4.2 real terms cut in local government funding over the last just 5 years, when Scottish government funding has reduced by just 0.8%. A fivefold increase, taking the cuts indeed passed on by the Tories to the Scottish government and increasing it fivefold. So let's talk frankly about the numbers. Let's not pretend there have been no cuts, because there have. And this is a crushing blow after the efforts by local government leaders, which is why all 32 local council leaders signed the letter stating that the cuts amount to £371 million in real terms in the current budget. And perhaps if the SNP benches want to deny that figure, they need to explain why so many of their own council leaders signed that letter. And indeed, perhaps we shouldn't be surprised by the lack of clarity by the SNP, because their time in government with regard to councils and local government has been marked by consistency. Look at council tax alone. They came into government heralding the fact that they were going to scrap council tax. And then latterly, they heralded that they were bringing the ability for councils to set their own council tax back. And then last year, they heralded that they were going to freeze council tax again, yet just to herald with this coming budget that yet again the discretion to set council taxes was going to be restored to local government. And which is it? I mean, I think we're all, I think, rightly confused by how they value local government, their approach to local government. And the reality is, over 10 years, local governments have seen almost £1 billion cut in real terms from their ability to spend. And ultimately, that impacts roads, schools, libraries and playgrounds. And those are the very services that are the fabric of our communities, the bedrock that so many people rely on. And so when we talk about these numbers, let's just remember what the real impacts are. And it's about real people and real communities, and that's who's suffering because of £1 billion worth of cuts from this SNP government over the last decade. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Johnson. I call on the Minister to conclude for around 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm grateful to members from across the Chamber for their contributions this afternoon. Still not getting used to this after 2 years. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Budget has focused on the key priorities of tackling inequalities, addressing climate change and supporting our economic recovery. Scotland's councils share these priorities, and it is clear that our citizens and communities are best served when we work together in partnership at a national and local level. If I could make a little bit more progress, please. In terms of that partnership, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Economy will join the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government and the Minister for Social Security and Local Government tomorrow for the inaugural Strategic Review Group meeting with the COSLA presidential team. That group will work to drive greater collaborative working, and at the first meeting they will discuss the implications of the budget in more detail. Next week, the First Minister will meet with the COSLA presidential team and political group leaders in response to their letter on the budget to discuss how best to tackle the new phases of the pandemic, to progress recovery and strengthen the partnership between national and local government in order to deliver for our communities. I'm going to make a little bit more progress because I'm very tight for time, I'm afraid. These meetings taking place at the highest levels of government highlight the priority that the Scottish Government places on working with local government to ensure that high-quality public services continue to be delivered across the country. The forthcoming resource spending review will also continue to focus on key priorities, and the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Economy is already engaging with COSLA as part of that process. The development of a fiscal framework will also have a direct relevance to the spending review. As I outlined in my opening statement today, a fiscal framework cannot be imposed on local government and must be developed in partnership. Scottish Government and COSLA have now recommenced discussions on the fiscal frameworks, which were paused during the pandemic, and substantive work will be taken forward this year. The development of a fiscal framework is also an important part of the ongoing work on the Local Governance Review, which considers how powers, responsibilities and resources are shared across national and local spheres of government and with communities. Presiding Officer, despite the overall reduction in the resources available in the Scottish Budget between 2021-22 and 2022-23, the total local government settlement has increased by £588.2 million, or 5.1% in real terms. Yes, these figures include the additional funding for prioritisations such as health and social care integration, for the expansion of free school meals and to provide additional teachers and support staff. But these are key priorities for all parties, and if the budget had not funded these members, then I am sure that the outrage being expressed today would have been redirected that way. I'll give way to Mr Johnson.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful, and I'll be brief. Would he also acknowledge, though, the Accounts Commission figures of that longer term, almost 5% real terms cut over 5 years?
Minister.
I would say that what is important to recognise is the context we've been in of an increasing health budget. And the reality is, and this is something that Willie Rennie alluded to in his space, we have protected the health budget. There has, to the best of my knowledge, always been a consensus around all health consequences being passed on. That is certainly the position of the government. But if other parties have a different view, then they should state so clearly. And perhaps that can inform their contributions with regards to where any additional resource for local government should come from in the budget. I still have some time remaining, Presiding Officer, is that correct?
That's correct, Mr Arthur, up
can
to 5 minutes.
Can I take the intervention from Mr Kerr?
Liam Kerr.
Thank you. I'm very grateful to the Minister for bringing me in. He mentioned climate change earlier on. Now, the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero requires local authorities to help achieve that net zero. Now, last week, the leader of Aberdeen City Council said the draft budget will have a severe impact on what we can do in this space. What impact does the Minister think a £371 million cut to council budgets will have on council's ability to meet net zero?
In closing, Minister.
In closing, President Officer, I think it's important to look at the total allocation to local government and also to look at the broader resources being allocated towards our net zero ambitions. And that has to be seen in its totality, including the support we are giving to the North East. To conclude, Presiding Officer, I would just reiterate the points that my colleague, the Cabinet Secretary, made in interventions. I recognise members want to see more money for local government, but this tends to be an annual debate, and year after year after year, what we do not hear is where that resource should come from. As I'm not making a political point, I am asking in all sincerity, if members want to see additional resource for local government, then from where should it come? And I think if we can get to that place, we will have an opportunity to have a far more constructive conversation and debate around local government finance. And I think that's something we would all welcome. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on Liz Smith to wind up for the Conservative Party. 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. When every single council leader in Scotland, including those in SNP-run councils such as Edinburgh and Glasgow and Dundee, are not only demanding a crisis meeting with the First Minister, but are also excoriating in their criticism of the budget settlement, that tells its own story. Local government has quite clearly had enough, and the anger transcends party politics. Indeed, it's plain for all to see that this budget settlement has been the last straw after the consecutive years of cuts that Daniel Johnson referred to. And councils are particularly concerned about their ability to provide core services and especially about the provision of health and social care delivery with its ever-pressing and increasing demands. Now, we know in this Parliament only too well that there's always some debate about budgets and their interpretation. Willie Rennie talked about the conjurer's tricks. Though I have to say, Mr Rennie, I think you were guilty of being a conjurer yourself, but only to be outdone by Mr Greer, who had extraordinary contortions today, quite separate from any of your Green colleagues would have said when you weren't in government. Absolutely. Now, this funding settlement, Minister, you were talking about what the Scottish Fiscal Commission was saying. They're also saying that both the Scottish Government and the local authorities are agreed on the fact that there is a cash terms settlement for 2021-22, 2022-23 that is exactly the same. And it is these core issues that go to the heart of this debate this afternoon, because it should be seen in the context of the fact that we have for financial year 2013-14, up till last year, the local government finance settlement decreased in real terms by 2.4%, whereas the Scottish Government's own budget in that time went up by 3.1%. So I wonder if you don't mind, because I think we're very pushed for time today. Normally, well, there's budget debates next week. So whatever the understandable and very reasonable calls might be made from other areas of Scottish Government funding, this local government is finding it completely impossible. They've been shortchanged and severely disadvantaged. And there's a bigger picture here too, Minister, because the proportion of the local government budget, which is ring-fenced, is now four times higher than it was 3 years ago. And of course, added to that, there are very significant legislative commitments placed upon local authorities because of the Scottish Government's own policy commitments. But when you strip away these legislative commitments about which councils have no discretionary option, there's virtually nothing left about which they can have real autonomy. And that's one of the big complaints that COSLA is making. Now, we note that the Scottish Government's argument for the extensive increase in ring fencing is because there is too great a variation in council performance. Now, we don't need to point out that the relationship between Scottish Government and the council is not particularly good just now, and it's probably a debate for another day about how we mend that process. But I hope the Minister can understand that for councils that are performing particularly well, this is an absolute slap in the face when it comes to how they carry out their business. Now, of course, it's true that we will have a situation in April where there will be some autonomy and freedom for local councils to set their own council tax rates without having to be obliged by the Scottish Government to keep to a particular cap. But every central government cut to local council finance means a huge potential increase in council tax. That's not my words. That was in the SNP manifesto not that long ago. Of course, it was the same manifesto, I think, where they were claiming that it was Scotland's oil. Now they don't seem to want that. Presiding Officer, if councils are to make the underfunding, as in to address the underfunding, then they're going to have to raise council tax. There's no other way out of it, this option. And that's why we are calling on a different settlement when it comes to the procedures of allowing an agreement between the national government and councils to do that. Presiding Officer, back on the 9th of December, when Kate Forbes presented her budget statement to Parliament, there was virtually no mention of local government, despite the fact that local authorities are delivering so many critical services, as several members have referred to today. But to many in this chamber and in local government, I think that speaks volumes about the disregard that this Scottish Government has for local authorities, not just now, but over a long period of time. Local authorities are not only complaining about being underfunded and under-resourced, but also about feeling, as Mark Griffin said, undervalued and constrained by the fact that they are increasingly tied to central government. In other words, they feel that they are having to carry the can for central government and for SNP policy failures. That's not fair, Presiding Officer, and that's why I support the motion in the name of Miles Briggs.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on protecting local government funding in Scotland, and it's now time to move on to the next item of business. And I'll just take this opportunity to remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the chamber and across the Holyrood campus.